звезды мировой пластической хирургии с Ольгой Засеевой. Эстетика в разрезе. Мустафа Хамди, профессор, доктор медицинских наук, директор клиники микрохирургии Королевского бельгийского общества пластической хирургии. Эстетика в разрезе.
How many times have you been in Russia?
Actually, I don't know, but many, many times. And I think this is a very good sign that somehow it's very good to come to Russia like every year almost and get contact with a doctor and with some friends also. Coming to Russia, it has really very nice significance for me because I never see such people eager for knowledge like the Russian doctors.
Really?
In Congress, what we notice when we come to teach all around the globe, the audience who stayed the longest in the way, in the day, or even the kid earlier in the day, they are by far the Russians. So this makes us, like a pleasure to come because we see that people, they appreciate our visit.
But you're a real star because each time when we say, okay, Mustafa is coming, they even refer that, oh, it was Mustafa Hamdi who tell us this and this because, yeah, they really like your presentation and your knowledge. When did you start to feel that you would like to share your knowledge? Because I have the cases in Russia when there's some of the doctors, they say, oh, no, I'm not ready to talk yet. I don't want to share my experience yet. I don't want to tell my tricks. But you are very open. You tell a lot of small and very important things for the good results. When did you start to feel that you would like to?
I think definitely at first, it goes back to your character, your personality. If you are somebody open to the community, the society, to the friends, to people that you are work with, this is the first and 100% this very important element in your approach to teaching. And then the fact that I'm in an academic setup, so I'm working in university hospital, whereas I'm a chief and a professor in university, although I do also private practice, but having the system then oblige you that to keep going and teaching and discussing every point because you raise residents. I told this is my kids for a few years and then I have really to take care of their education. Having this mentality, you make yourself also like a good teacher, which influenced myself because when you are a good teacher, then you become a really very good surgeon. So it's not only like for the benefit of my residents, also for my benefit, because this make you think about issues, topics, step in the surgery, analyze your result, and be very critical to yourself and even for the other, of course, and then try to share this experience with anybody else. I do believe sharing experience is very important. And again, this is not only for the benefit of myself, but I do believe for benefit of the field, the specialty, and also our patients. By share some experience, you might maybe somebody else avoiding having complication for another patient. So then we really provide our patient and the society for a better level of safety and of course higher level of result and outcome. And I always make joke, of some of my colleagues who doesn't, he did it. They are very close. Although they are excellent surgeons, but they are not able to communicate with other people or they are not willing to present. I find this is a bit selfish. You can be, the best person in the world, but if you don't leave behind you this package of experience or knowledge so somebody else will use it, you will be forgotten.
Эстетика в разрезе.
And I think it's not what you achieve, it's what you produce and somebody else use, and this is what we call legacy. So if you believe in legacy, well, you have to teach, you have to criticize yourself, and you have to leave package for somebody behind you.
And what about the competition? Because most of the colleagues think that, okay, if I will share my experience with someone, so the competitor will jump over and I will be behind. And then the patients will go to this new established.
There is two things. I think, again, back to your personality. I don't believe that anybody can steal anybody from any, it's like it's your destiny, it's written. If you have to write to establish this innovation, it's going to be for you. Colleagues, friends, they use the ideas of each other and they develop them. It can be then difficult when somebody claim that he invented, you know, this technique or this surgery or this anatomy, and do not give a credit to the other people. Then it might be a problem among, you know, the specialties. And unfortunately, it can happen too. But this shouldn't really be like an obstacle to make secrecy. You know, I don't want to share this with anybody because otherwise they're gonna steal it and they're gonna be better than me. This is untrue. There's only your hard work and your outcome will give you really your you know your level in knowledge and also in the society. And I travel the whole year. I give everything I know. I never felt that somebody actually exceeded me because he get more information. Absolutely not. I always see that. Gratitude that you see that those people come to you and then, oh, thank you very much because I saw this last time from you and it works, and I really appreciate what I learned from you. It's really a great pleasure.
Звезды мировой пластической хирургии с Ольгой Засеевой. Эстетика в разрезе. Мустафа Хамди, профессор, доктор медицинских наук, директор клиники микрохирургии Королевского бельгийского общества пластической хирургии.
In case you have some questions, to whom do you ask these questions? Do you have sort of colleagues or older friends to whom you could ask some question if you have?
Yeah. Once again, I think in our field, you have to put the pride on the side. You cannot claim that you know everything. You cannot claim that you can solve every problem. And yeah, from time to time, yeah, we can maybe put a picture, you know, and on the somehow in our group, media closer group, and ask for advice on what you would do for this patients. Guys, I did this, didn't work well. What do you believe on that? And fortunately, we have, you know, a couple of groups. They are professionals, and also most of them they are friends of mine. So we can share idea and learn from mistakes of each other, of course. And it's happened, and you know, sometime without feeling that, because I come to here, I see, you know, many presentations from our colleagues, and I see some tricks that, oh, maybe if I do that, then probably I can avoid such situation. So it's all also like asking advice, but and indirectly. And what I mean by that, then you have to go and see other stuff and, you know, analyze it and think about it. It's also kind of advice.
Эстетика в разрезе.
If we are talking about the patients, tell me, in your practice, the women's beauty, how it was changed in with the years? Was it the bigger size of the breast? Was it like bigger eyes, bigger volumes, or what?
I think it still belongs to the culture and the you know, different societies. The part of the world, they believe in a big breast. Some of them, they believe in big, you know, butt. Some other society, they believe in the wide, you know, hip. So it's, I think it's still something cultural, but with the media, we become almost to one word. So the media put people together.
Hollywood standard.
Yeah. So, and I don't believe that is good. I don't believe this is good. We are losing really this diversity in colors and culture and differences, you know, than the other part of the world. But you are right. I think the media, the mode, fashion, people who is actually on the media and fashion, they change a lot of the concept of people. So it happened to us many times that they come with, you know, piece of journal or magazine.
I want to do this.
And of course, you cannot provide the same result with the tissue that the patient had, like been the quality of the skin, the breast, etc., etc. This is on us to re-educate the patients. And actually, also we have to be involved in the fashion and the mode, let's say, you know, creator. For years, if you notice that fashion is being done by 80-90% by very strange males. I will use only the word strange because it seems you have to be strange to be creative. I don't know. So I think It doesn't make sense to have only one side vision. I think you have to get psychological aspect. You have to get financial aspect. You have to find also like artistical, people, and also doctors, because they really influence the needs and the demand of the patient by posting those extremely, slim women and
falling down on the podium
because they don't eat. So this is, I do believe, not really doing good for the society. And I really appreciate some of the movement in the fashion mode that way. They use just normal women, to move. And they are pretty, they are beautiful, and they fit.
And they need to somehow to dress also.
Of course. It's, I think, time to look at this issue once again and not accept it like it's been since like 2-3 decades in the same way.
Звезды мировой пластической хирургии с Ольгой Засеевой. Эстетика в разрезе. Мустафа Хамди, профессор, доктор медицинских наук, директор клиники микрохирургии Королевского бельгийского общества пластической хирургии.
In terms of competition between Europe and United States, who is the first? Who is, let's say, technically equipped or better, could better serve the patient?
Yeah, well, of course, we're gonna see we European. Now, I think we are working the same direction. The circumstances are different. They work and much more restriction from juridic part, lawsuit, lawyers chasing them everywhere. This can give some restriction in their work. So many of the new methods or new techniques, they are not easily, introduced to the United States, because the surgeon, our colleague, American, plastic surgeon, they might have some concern toward, the laws system in the United States. If they are sued, it's going to be big trouble. And the patients lobby differently in the United States with the marketing and media that they have. It might, give them some hard time. And so I do believe that we both camps, they do really good quality, differently, good quality of surgery, approach to the patients. But maybe in Europe, we still have this kind of freedom, to introduce a new thing and to achieve maybe even better result faster than the United States.
Why? Is it because you require less clinical trials, less
I think you still have some bureaucracy and restriction, but I think European patient might accept a new concept much easier than the American.
So American is more?
They are more, close to the point, and they want really something that has been working for like one or two decades. They can sue you easier, which is a pity. I know that we are catching up in Europe. We have some cases like this, but it was still incomparable to American system, fortunately.
Yeah, I remember that Brian Kinney presented the big building, and he told me, okay, look, this is my office. This is like 16 floors plastic surgery, and another 25 is the lawyers, because the lawyer is from the both side, one from the side of the doctor and another one from the side of the patient. And this is really, we are facing now the same issue in Russia when the patients start to sue the doctors for getting money back for the procedure which even have been successful. So, and I think this is something where society need to protect doctor, or what is your opinion? How to protect, how to, because doctor, I think, take a lot of responsibilities.
I think there is two things can be done at this level. Definitely the scientific society, professional society, like, I presume you have here Russian Association of Plastic Surgery or something like that. So this society should really make a great effort for patient educations and also to protect the surgeon. We are not to protect complications, we are not to protect errors, but we are protecting this, reaction from the media, patients sometimes, and backup by the lawyers. And it should be like, in a certain way, whenever a case come, like you have a group of, extremely experienced surgeon related to the association, where we can really make decision quickly and not make the case going on for years. This is extra cost for the patient, for the doctor, and for the society. Somebody has to pay the bill. So I think whenever it comes at the first level and the those, you know, jury of experts said, oh, there's nothing wrong, there is no error, this should be just stopped. Otherwise, what we'll see that the process, you know, taking like years, and both sides are just putting money, and everybody, I think, losing. At the same time, I said the other effort, of course, patient education. So patients should know what is good, what's bad, what's average, what is complication, where they have to stand up and ask, oh, the surgeon really didn't do the good job, and I need to be corrected. So this kind of campaign should be done by the professionals association. Every doctor has his own part to spread the good information, and of course with very close cooperation with the government. If the government do not back you up, then everything will fall down once again. So having this kind of good relationship between the scientific society and the, you know, juridic part related to the government will make this maybe much more under regulation than everybody just free, you know, let's go and sue the doctor, you know, even for nothing.
Эстетика в разрезе.
What is the difference between good surgeon and excellent surgeon?
I think we have a lot of good surgeon. The excellent surgeon, this is the surgeon that who is really dedicated to his profession. And sometimes, unfortunately, you need to sacrifice with something. So only people who are willing to sacrifice a part of their private life from whatever, you know, their own time, they will be excellent.
So there are no balance?
It's very difficult. Everybody claimed that, okay, I'm looking for the balance, including myself. I'm, you know, with this issue and the questions since more than 20 years, it's extremely difficult to find the balance. I think it's very important to look for the balance, but nobody can really claim after whiteout, oh no, I just achieved the balance. This is, at least in my experience, is difficult or almost impossible to achieve.
But plastic surgery, it's not an emergency. It's more or less you could plan your life or not.
That's true, but to make things good, then you need time. And most of cases with all what happened in the modern life, unfortunately, we have a lot of paperwork. We have also a lot of logistic and especially in university hospital. And 24 hours sometimes is not enough per day. Even people declaim that I don't want to work on the weekend. Well, I work on the weekend sometimes. If you are not able or accepting to do that, I think it's very difficult to be excellent. You might be good, even very good, but if you want to be distinguished, I'm sad to say that, because there's no other solution. Otherwise, you're gonna sacrifice the other good thing too, like the teaching, no publication, you know, and then you can get better balance for private life, of course, and it's still good doing good job for your patient.
Звезды мировой пластической хирургии с Ольгой Засеевой. Эстетика в разрезе. Мустафа Хамди, профессор, доктор медицинских наук, директор клиники микрохирургии Королевского бельгийского общества пластической хирургии.
Мустафа, the last question. What is your opinion about the future of the plastic? Is it surgery or it's a new plastic, new technology which will kill the surgery as a profession?
It's too early to reach such a level. I think this is what everybody believe, that we will be able to create like tissue
robot
engineering and some material and technology will regenerate the skin, will regenerate the lost tissue after a trauma or a cancer or accident, whatever. I think we are going in the right way, but I'm sure that won't be happen in my life. So at least we will have 50 years before that achieving 50% what we are talking about. And I do believe that medicine should much more focus in healing disease and cancer rather than just talking about beauty and tissue regeneration. We work together side by side, so surgery and non-invasive procedure, because I think they are complementary, but I don't believe that at this stage that the last one will replace the first one.
But in any case, engineer, we will need engineer to repair So in that case, I think the surgery will stay forever. Because I have no idea how it is possible, even with the new technology, and to implement the new technology into the body. You need someone who will do it.
To make the extreme border, I think the day that we can find out how this salamander regenerate his tail, then we will solve all this problem. But I think we need many, many years.
Yeah, but salamander doesn't ride.
But by genetic manipulation, by the tissue engineering, I think there is a way to get to the clue, but we are not that close. And I have just to add one thing, you know, and you talk about technology, arts, and we spend a lot of time about that. This is why we create our meeting, the CADBAS, which is about controversy, arts, and technique. It's really the essence of our specialty. We do it every couple of years. It's in a breast and body contouring, and next version will be in September 25th to 27th. And I'm so glad, and I hope to see our Russian colleagues together with you, Olga, coming to Brussels, and thank you very much.
Звезды мировой пластической хирургии с Ольгой Засеевой. Эстетика в разрезе.